All praise be to the Most High Elohim. This is Apostle Grigsby, delivering the word of truth here in the earth realm on behalf of Yahweh and Yahweh Shai, our Lord and our Savior, the Savior of Israel, his chosen elect, the Savior of the entire earth. For it is written, for the earth is the Lord's, the fullness thereof, the world and all they that dwell there within. Alleluia. Amen. Okay. Oh, today there will be a continuation of the last message on being God's vessel in the earth. And we kind of touched bases on the desires of the Lord, the reason why he created us, he elected us, he appointed us, those type of things. So on today, we're going to close this thing out. You know, 1 Corinthians 6 and 20. Says, for you are bought with a price, therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. So we will purchase, actually purchase from an ancient civilization by which the Most High Elohim regenerated our deoxyribonucleic acids, which is our DNA, through the lineage of Adam, through his son, what? His son himself. So remember, there was a division between the two sons after Cain slayed Abel. And so Seth had a lineage throughout the Adamic bloodline. And then Cain, he had a lineage throughout that Adamic bloodline. So over the years, these two bloodlines, you know, engaged in supernatural or cosmic conflict. We know most things are manifest in the heavenly realm first before, most things occur in the heavenly realm first before they manifest here in the earth realm. So technically, the cosmic conflict eventually, manifested itself here in the earth realm. So this conflict is continuing throughout the ages. And now is the time of fulfillment. We are at the end, and the earth is crying out unto the Most High Elohim from the ground. All the blood that has been shed through guerrilla warfare, the blood of the souls that were lost, those who died in innocence, but they were martyred, is crying out from the ground. Ground can be also considered Sheol or the grave, all right? Those sacred chambers in the earth that holds the soul until that regeneration cycle where they are resurrected from their sleep, which means to be awakened and brought forth back upon the earth realm during the period of judgment. And a lot of those things are transpiring now. They're transpiring now, all right? So, for those who believe in the spiritual law that's written in the Word of God, we have been converted over as God's creatures or his vessels in the earth. And there is a certain mandate, a charge, by which we have to subscribe to and yield ourselves to, so we can be active representatives of the Most High here in the earth realm. Okay, 1 Corinthians 6 and 19 says, what, know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, which is in you? Okay, that's the Spirit of the Lord, the eternal Ruha HaKodesh, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own. So you were purchased. I think we kind of elaborated on part one of being God's vessel in the earth. We elaborated on the Most High calling the Abrahamic lineage out of Ur and ancient Samaria. And through the Abrahamic lineage, he regenerated the bloodline of Adam and Seth. All right. Regeneration means to resurrect. Okay. So you also talked about how spiritual phenomena can attach to the DNA. okay? Spiritual phenomenon can attach to your DNA, okay? Because you are a spirit. Remember that the DNA records information. It passes information down from one generation to another hereditarily, okay? That's called chromosomal inheritance, all right? Where you inherit information passed down from your parents, their parents, on down to your generation, and then after you have children, then the next generation, right? But so the Most High is some sort, you can say, not only a creator, but he's a multifaceted supernatural entity that's capable of supernatural feats. Okay, he's a planner, he's a scientist, he's an economist, you name it, physicist, chemist, most high have. He has all those divine characteristics. Remember the word say that the pupil is not greater than their master. So since our master called us unto himself to raise us up and to place himself within us, then all of those qualities distributed by the Holy Spirit is now made manifest within us. We call those spiritual gifts, all right? A lot of times those spiritual gifts is birthed through the physical body. And that's why we had to keep the physical body clean, okay? So that goes back to what it said, ye have of God and ye are not your own. You're no longer your own. You have been bought for a price. You have been purchased out of the earth unto a supernatural inheritance through Christ. Okay, so think it not strange when all of these various events start to occur in the earth realm. Think it not strange, all right? They're bound to happen because remember the earth herself, by which the physical body comes from the soul or the mold, right? She was created by the Most High, okay? In certain ancient civilizations, they call her Gaia, okay? That's in Greek. So in the Greek diaspora, they call her Gaia, aka Mother Earth, by which we live upon. But our physical bodies was taken from the dust of the earth. Dust meaning soul. Okay, that translation should be from the soul of the earth. All right, that's what clay is. Clay is soul. So the Lord and his divine wisdom manufactured this body to house our soul so that he could place his spirit within us and we can become like him over time. Okay, so the more you keep the law of the Lord and the word of the Lord, you become more like him. Okay, all praise and glory be to the Most High Elohim, who grants us this type of wisdom and who blesses us to have these elaborative conversations pertaining to who we are in him, even after we fought hard through hardship, trials and tribulations by the hand of the enemy. But these things have to occur to strengthen us and bring us back unto ourselves. Remember, the physical bodies are only temporary unto those who are regenerated in Christ. That means those who die in Christ eventually will be resurrected in Christ unto a new form, a new body. The word say that we know not now what we shall be, but we know that once he returns, we shall be like him. This is talking about the whole transmutation. Transmutation is a transformation, alchemical transformation, where the molecules within the body, the atoms, are all transformed, okay? Transformed, they're not the same. So your biochemical composition is not going to be the same, okay? Your molecular arrangements are not going to be the same. They're going to become divine. Whatever you have now is only, it's a suit or a vessel by which the soul has to go through a series of experiences before you come back into spiritual maturity. All right. Remember, what did Christ say when he was challenged by the Sanhedrin, the Sadducees, the Pharisees, and the teachers of the law. They were, antagonizing him about being the son of God, because they said, what are you going around saying you're the son of God? What did Christ say? He used scripture. He said, is it not written in your holy scripture that ye are gods, which translates to ye are Elohim? But in the Old Testament, right after he said, for ye are gods, or ye are Elohim, what did it say? You shall die like men, but you shall die like men and shall fall like one of the princes. Okay? That speaks about the sinful nature and action of the Elohim. Okay? So, the more you behave immaturely, eventually, that nature of sin is going to pay off. Okay? Or you're going to have to pay up as a price. The word says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ. So the wage of sin, meaning the penalty of sin, is death. Something's going to have to die. You're going to have to give something in exchange for the seeds in which you've sown. Okay? Remember, a seed has to die before it can be regenerated or brought back to life through a process. Once a seed is sown, it's going to go through a process. It might not manifest the embryonic vessel within may not manifest itself or protrude through the seed coat instantaneously, unless you got some type of supernatural miracle growth. All right, but it may not manifest itself almost instantaneously, but it will eventually awaken and push itself through the soil and become a plant, produce flowers. The flowers are going to produce fruit, okay? But it takes time. Everything has a process. So sin, the wages of sin has a process by which one would have to go through. This body had to go through a process, all right, of dying. The original Adamic figure, which we call Adama or Adam, in the book of Genesis, he originally had a celestial covering. But when he sinned, when he ate of the fruit of the tree of what? Of the knowledge of good and evil, he began to die. What does the Lord say? The day you eat of this fruit, you shall surely die. But we have to acknowledge that on the celestial field, because the Lord is eternal, and he measures time and eons. The word say, for what a day is unto the Lord, a thousand years is unto the Lord a day. So their lifespan at that time was based off of the celestial sphere of time. Their measurement of time was in eons. Okay? Until sin attached itself to the flesh through the action of man, and man entered into his fallen state. Okay? So, Adam was originally God's vessel here on earth. He even called Adam his son. Until he ate of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and his eyes were awakened. So he died that day. He didn't reach 1,000 years old. That was the unit of measurement, or the standard measurement of time in his era from the Garden of Eden. Okay? Remember, the Garden of Eden is a totally different dimension. So once they were cast out of the Garden of Eden, the body, the celestial covering, was removed. The Lord left his ruha within him, but he gave him what we call this right here. This is really, in ancient times, they would call this animal flesh. This would be animal flesh, all right? That means it was corruptible, beast-like. But the celestial covering allowed Adam and Eve to commune in the company of angels and with the Most High till they was cast out of the garden. So the original vessel of man was celestial. It was celestial. They were created in the likeness and in the image of the Most High. And we're talking about the biochemical composition of the body was celestial. It was metaphysical in its essence. That means, even though Adam possibly could not fly like the angels, because he bare witness the angels what ascending and descending into the earth realm in the Garden of Eden. So they had certain abilities that even Adam still didn't have, because the word records that man was created just a little bit lower than the angels. The Malach, that's another translation for the angels, or the Bene Elohim, right? But Adam himself was a Bene Elohim, which means a son of the Most High. Elohim, the son of God. Okay? So, this is me putting things in simple form. But Adam originally had a celestial body. He was God's vessel. He housed the soul and the spirit of the Most High. He was learning from the Most High. And the Most High used him as a principal figure in the earth realm. He was a king. He was a ruler. He was a god. This is what upset Satania. All right? So Satania challenged Adam and Eve in the garden. Take away their authority. How did he do this? How did he accomplish this? Through temptation. Right? That's how we did it. And once Adam sinned, his body began to degenerate. Look that term up, degenerate. Right? So, over time, the more sin began to mature in the earth realm, when the sons of men began to be born. And they started partaking all manner of evil and began to awaken. Right, so they were conscious of their sin to a certain extent, okay? Because you do have a moral consciousness already inside of you. Even before you introduced to the word of the Lord, there is a divine code within you that helps you to acknowledge or bear witness to right and wrong. So you can discern between righteousness and unrighteousness until you are blinded by the God of this world, when you continue to participate in sin and blaspheme the name of the Lord and disregard the voice of the Lord that's telling you what to do and what not to do. So eventually you become desensitized to the convictions of the Holy Spirit. And that's what causes you to descend down into darkness. Okay? So what not to do in God's body according to his commandments. We just briefly covered that. Say, should we sin in the body, and are the commandments done away with? Okay? So what not to do in God's body according to his commandments? Let me make it simple. Sin. Do not sin in God's body. Even though you don't have the incorruptible body yet, this body still belongs to the Most High Elohim, because it's from the earth. And the words say, for the earth is the Lord. See what I'm saying? So, stay away from sin. Also say, should we sin in the body? I think last time on the last message, please watch part one, being God's vessel in the earth, part one. We cover what sin was. Sin is the transgression of the law. All right. The law is God's commandments, his statutes, his precepts. Okay. Things that we are supposed to learn in the body so that we may live and not die. I mean, our soul, because we are a soul spirit. Okay. Say, should we sin in the body, and are the commandments done away with? We shouldn't sin in the body. We shouldn't practice sin. We shouldn't participate in sin. If we see sin, we're supposed to either rebuke it in our brethren, those who walk according to the spirit, those who desire to come out of the world. We should rebuke them, convict them, through the power of the Holy Spirit, through the word of truth, and we should introduce the law unto them, for only through the law can they be saved. We talked about Christ being the manifestation of the law in the flesh, that is written. All right. I said, are the commandments done away with? No, the commandments are not done away with. Okay, I'm gonna read you the scripture, Matthew 5:17-20. Says, think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill. That's Matthew 5:17-20. Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. This is Christ speaking. He said, think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill. Okay, he had to fulfill. And if we are to be like him, then we are to fulfill what we can through the power of the Spirit. The Spirit will quicken us through a heart of repentance to fulfill the law. Okay? So this is why we have grace according. See, we view grace from a metaphorical, theological perspective. It ain't philosophical, it's more, it's theological. All right? There's the theologian school of thought, their faith-based systems, how they perceive the word of the Lord to be, how they translate the word of the Lord based off of the condition of their brain, how they generate information, and they enforce their will on others through religious systematic dogma and control. But now we hear right here that Christ is saying, I am not come to destroy but to fulfill. We also can acknowledge that we still have a cross to bear ourselves. So he didn't bear our cross, he bare his cross to be an example unto us. We covered that. The apostles were examples unto us. Christ was their apostle, their bishop, their headship, and the 12 became, the headship of the early church, the regenerated church, okay, in the New Testament. So they had to fulfill their purpose in the earth as well. That's what the cross is. And you can only fulfill that purpose through suffering. All right, through suffering, okay? There's a blessing, but not without suffering. The word says, for they that suffer with Christ shall also reign with Christ. I reckon not the present suffering of this day and time is even worthy to be compared to the future glory that is in Yahweh HaMashiach. So it's something you have to earn your crown. That's what overcoming is. It ain't just given, you got to earn it. But Christ came to open up the door so you would be able to be regenerated and reinstituted back into God's divine alignment, his original plan for your life, the original plan that he had for man. Okay, you can participate in that. You can inherit that once again. And it's a certain lineage that he preserved through genetics that can inherit that blessing, but they have to inherit it through faith. That means they have to believe. If they don't believe, it doesn't matter if they're the biological lineage or not. They still have to believe. The word says, for now faith comes by hearing by the word, of God. They had to believe the word of God. Then that's where their faith comes from. Their faith in who? The Most High Elohim, the Elohim of Israel, the Lord of all the earth. Okay, if we read on in Matthew 5:17-20, it says, for verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law, till all be fulfilled. Has all been fulfilled yet? No, it's still events that are being fulfilled in the earth realm right now, because we're living in the time of the end. We're living in a degeneration age. Perilous times, what sin shall what multiply in the earth, and it's multiplying in the earth. We're seeing all manner of degeneracy, sexually explicit material. The internet is flooded with pornography. Children have access to pornography. Women are not dressing in modest apparel. They're like in the days of Enoch. They're wearing makeup, long, sharp nails, like talons on a bird, those type of things. High heel, 8 to 10 inch high heels. They're scripting on poles. Even men, they got men scripting on poles. They're participating in, they modifying their body. That's what they're doing. They hate God's law. When you bring up God's law, when you bring up this truth, they reject it almost instantaneously. This is the world that we're living in. I'm not going to go too deep in that, but that's sin. They're participating in homosexual acts, acts of pedophilia. And all this is trickling down from the head of world organizations such as entertainment, religion, the churches. Many of your pastors participate in, they may even have pastors who have ties in occultism, and they're just disguised as religious figures, speaking falsehood and lies. That's what a false teacher is. They know the truth. They're not going to give it to you. So they control you. They're going to teach you what's going to keep you coming back to the sanctuary, not what can save your soul or what can help you produce a thought process or independent thought of them. Meaning that the purpose of the word is to help you become enlightened so you can think for yourself, so you can serve the Lord for yourself, so you can have a righteous relationship with the Most High for yourself, so you can play your part within the organization of the body of believers. But they got you, they got the masses, the people, the congregations, almost animatronic, robotic, cybernetic. They programmed you. So now you got to break that program through the word. You need to awaken. So they're using God's original vessels that he designated for himself for their purpose. Because they can't function without a vessel. They want you, okay? These wicked organizations, they want you. But we'll move on. So Christ in verse 19 says, whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments and shall teach men so, he shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever shall do and teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I say unto you, that except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, ye shall in no case enter into the kingdom of heaven. So he's telling you, ain't no one saved, always saved. It's a process. He said, except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees. Remember, they were self-righteous. They were hypocrites. They knew the word. They had the scriptures. They had the scrolls. They dressed in priestly garments. So the physical attraction was there. But they didn't have any anointing, any true authority. They didn't speak with authority because they weren't living the life that they were teaching. He says, shall in no case enter into the kingdom of heaven. That means if you're not living a righteous lifestyle, a repentant lifestyle, then guess what? You won't be entering in the kingdom of heaven. If you continue on in your sins and you don't change your thought process or your actions, which is what true repentance is, not just confessing, because you can confess and go right back to it, then you won't enter into the kingdom of heaven. Remember, the kingdom of heaven is spiritual, and the kingdom of heaven is governed by law, divine law and order. So you're not going to be coming, entering into the kingdom of heaven, telling God what to do, like most of you do. Talking to him about grace and unmerited favor. Say, no, you got to keep the law. Or you're not going to remain here, or you're not going to enter into the gates of the kingdom of heaven at all. You're going to die in your sin, and you're going to wake up in hellfire. That's the stipulation. That's the charge. And that charge hasn't changed. All right? So I encourage you, brethren, to return back to the Most High Elohim, because judgment is in the earth. Judgment is in the earth. It's in the earth. And it's going to continue until all be fulfilled. For God is not a man that he should lie, neither is he the son of man that he should change his mind. That's written. If he said it, it's going to be done. It shall be established. It shall be made manifest. He wants to see you saved. He wants to see you free. He wants to see you liberated. But you got to make that choice. You got to have a strong desire to awaken. Yeah, you're going to suffer. You're going to suffer. Because some of you have sold endless seeds of controversy, strife, immorality. So you have to pay for it to a certain extent. If you repent, you won't pay the full penalty. If you don't repent, you're going to pay the full penalty because you're not in Christ. The word says, for therefore there is no condemnation to those who are in Christ. Yeshua. You have to do something. You have to something. Where it say for be got to get it. Be not deceived, for God is not mocked. As a man soweth, thank you, Spirit. As a man soweth, also shall he reap. Ain't no getting around that. You abuse God. You abuse the temple, the tabernacle, the physical vessel, the vehicle that God gave you here in the earth realm. Then there's going to be consequences and repercussions until the Lord cleans you up, until he completely purifies you and cleans you up. You're going to feel the effects of sin until you're liberated from this earth completely. That's just how it is. But he loves you enough. That's what grace is, a period to get it right. Not for you to say, well, the seeds in which I've sown, you know, I keep saying it. That's not what that is. That means stop. Stop sinning. Turn away from your sins. Come back to God. Repent of your sins, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. That's the message. And everything else is going to work itself out. Everything else is going to work itself out. Right? So I'm blessing to the Most High Elohim. I pray that this word will be made manifest in your heart, mind, body, and soul. I got a part 3 that's coming up immediately after this. I have to finish this thing up. Okay? But I'm going to take a quick break, and we're going to return back to the message and close being God's vessel in the earth. We're going to close this topic out. If you have any questions, please feel free to reach out, and I'll try to answer those questions to the best of my ability. All blessing, praise be unto the eternal Yah, our Father who art in heaven, the Elohim of Yisrael, Yeshua HaMashiach, our Lord and our Savior. Amen.